So you said you were personally invested in making sure the public got to see as much as possible. Why was that important to you?
Well, I was personally invested in this being an investigation, too, because there was a dispute at the beginning about whether what we would do would be to listen to, and the expression then was wise men, and having listened to wise men say what the problems were and what the remedies were, then we would just come out with a report about reflecting what they told us and what we thought would be the right remedy. I fought very hard against that and was successful because I said, no, if we don't prove real harm that affects our democracy and affects ordinary people, we will never build the kind of public reform or support for change that we need.
What lessons did you learn about government secrecy during the course of your investigation?
Well, there's too much.
Yeah.
It lasts too long. It too often is for reasons of avoiding embarrassment or concealing improper or otherwise illegal conduct. But there's also some legitimate secrecy. And if you don't recognize that you have to draw that distinction and be careful about it, you won't succeed in your investigation. And the parallel House committee, which eventually was known as the Pike Committee, was doing some very good work, particularly about the CIA, about the quality of their intelligence. But at the end of the day, they were a really unfortunate failure because they never mastered the understanding of the difference between legitimate secrecy and illegitimate, and they would take unnecessary ideological positions like you can't block out the name of a informer in the first instance when you produce the documents to us, or we're not going to have a real dialogue with you about what our reports will say. And so they foundered at the beginning and they failed at the end because they didn't address the subject of secrecy with any sophistication.
And when there's a debate in the public about secrecy, often it focuses on overclassification, and that's obviously a rampant problem. But in the book, you argue that that's sort of too narrow a lens to view this problem, and that there are inherent dangers in secrecy.
Yeah, I'll give two conceptual points on that. One is the practice of making decisions in the White House with only a group of yes men in the room. And that's a very dangerous practice. It's very common. It was common during the Vietnam War. It's been common since 9/11, particularly under the Bush administration. But Obama administration, too, has had too many closed White House decision-making processes. And that increases the chance of error. And another danger that's way beyond classification is sometimes there are examples of very appropriate classification which nobody thinks about changing and releasing the information even though it's properly classified. And I'll give two examples of that. One would be the Bush administration's, the Bush White House's, they got a lot of warnings from the CIA that a calamitous event was being planned by Al-Qaeda. It was something that would be much, 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 much more serious than anything that had been done before. Without thinking, they just kept those secret. I'm convinced, and I argue in the book, that if the warnings had been disclosed to the public and to every government worker responsible for worrying about terrorist attacks, we would have thwarted the 9/11 attack. Another example also of an iconic event in American history was the Cuban Missile Crisis. the Russians had undercover and without our learning about it until we had U-2 flights that picked it up in Cuba, put in nuclear missiles and nuclear warheads in Cuba. And we successfully, ultimately, largely by JFK and the rest of his administration being tough, got the Russians to back down. But little known, not known at the time, and not well enough known even now, was the night before the resolution, Bob Kennedy, the Attorney General, the President's brother, a person ambitious on his own for ultimately becoming president, as comes out in some of the dialogue about this, goes to see the Russian ambassador and says, if you don't back down, we're going to escalate against you. He gives a threat first. But then he says, if you back down, we will make a deal with you to remove our missiles, land-based missiles in Turkey, equally close to Russia as Cuba is to southern United States. But, he said, that has to be kept secret and never known. Now, that deal was made, and it didn't become known for 20 or 30 years. This had some very harmful impacts. Again, it was legitimately secret at the time. Mm-hmm. Because if we'd announced the day of the deal, the day of the settlement of the missile crisis, that we'd made this deal involving Turkey, our allies would have said, United States, when it gets in trouble, it'll sell us down the river. Now, that's not something that was a problem later on, because other missiles, sea submarine missiles were put in there and so forth. But while legitimate at the beginning, for diplomatic reasons, the diplomatic reasons disappeared, and it was kept secret for all the remaining years because it was thought to be inconsistent with the reputations of the assassinated John Kennedy and the ambitions of the ambitious Robert Kennedy, who himself, unfortunately, was later assassinated also. And it really was kept secret until the 90s. Well, why did that matter? One thing it did is it deprived the American public of an object lesson that democracy is not just a fist in the face of your opponent. You make deals. It's not a blinking eye contest, which people will recognize from a Rusk metaphor of it was we were eyeball to eyeball and the other side just back down. So the first harm was to the sophistication of the American people. But in addition, McGeorge Bundy, who was one of the people who did know the secret, and there were only 9 people in the administration that knew the secret, the 2 brothers and 7 others. McGeorge Bundy, in his book later, Danger and Survival, says, I think this helped lead to the overthrow of Khrushchev 2 years later. Khrushchev was the Russian premier at the time of the missile crisis. And he was, for those days, a moderate and was replaced by a more hardline Soviet communist. And another more subtle problem and harder to prove, but I think likely, is that LBJ, who succeeded Kennedy and was always haunted by the Kennedy mystique, I think when he was dealing with Vietnam, that a factor, you can't say it's the factor, but a factor in his toughness, his felt need to appear tough, was, well, my sainted, who we didn't like very much, but my, that's unfair, who we had troubles with, John Kennedy. But my predecessor was known to win this incredible struggle just by being tough, when in fact, Kennedy won by being tough and by being willing to make a deal.